Hello there and welcome. And I hope that you will take time to stay with me for the next half hour. I have somebody very special sitting here with me, Major Michael Middleton, United States Marines, retired. And he now has his own company, but he has a great deal of wisdom, I think, to share with us. And I'm honored to have you.
Good to be here. Thank you for coming. Thanks, Peggy.
Thank you. Many people are concerned and upset, and it's not a safe world, but maybe it's never been a safe world. I mean, if you were going across the country in a covered wagon to live out west, in that western move, that wasn't safe.
No.
I'm not sure that our world was ever safe. There are always challenges, always things to be met. And it seems to me that the United States Marines have always been right there.
We like to say so. We certainly like to say so. And I think you're right. I don't think the world has ever been, you know, a perfect safe place or what we'd like to see it as. But,
no.
You know, one of the things that is shocking to me that I kind of like to look at and talk about is, although the world may still not be safe, what I find probably most disturbing is usually there's been some leadership somewhere to face those dangers, to stand up and call a spade and say, listen, this is wrong and we're going to do something about it. And I don't see that type of leadership within our government, especially at the senior levels, and sometimes in the military in our senior levels, especially in this day and age. I think a lot of times our military leaders are stifled to a certain degree because of the political process and because of our political leadership, where they'd like to be doing one thing or saying another. They're really stifled from doing so. And that's always been the case in our country, and that's been, you know, how we modeled our country and how it's supposed to be. I mean, we're always going to have civilian leadership of our military.
Well, we have to have the support of the top in our government to undergird our military.
Absolutely.
And it isn't there right now.
I think it's lacking, but also if you take a step back from that, I think the bigger picture that I always look at is, I think for a long time in this country, our senior political leadership has a very bad understanding of the purpose and the employment of the U.S. military. As I always tell people, the use of the military in this country is a light switch. It is not a rheostat, and it should be treated as such. And what I mean by that is, I am certainly of the school that says you should do everything in your power to never go to war, to ever have to use your military. Build up for it, have a strong military, have a very well-trained, lethal military, and do everything you can to never employ it. But if you do decide to employ it, you better do a couple things. First of all, you better get the consent of the citizens of this country, which our Constitution says we need to do by going to Congress and actually declaring war, receive a declaration of war, which we haven't done for decades. We've substituted things such as authorization of force or use of force, which basically gives everybody an out, the president, the Congress, and the citizens for that matter, because we don't demand it. So you better get everybody on board if you're going to go to war. And then when you go to war with everything you have so that it is as lethal and brutal in as short a period of time as possible, and then be done with it. Because as we're seeing now, after 8, 10, 12 years of kind of trickle war, as I call it, nothing's resolved. And many times it becomes worse.
And we have lost lives. We've had wounded because of this. And yet nothing has really, it's not black and white. It's not accomplished.
You know, it was so disheartening before I retired from the Marine Corps. And, you know, after almost, you know, when I was getting my 20-year mark when I retired, I had an opportunity to spend a lot of time with younger pilots and younger Marines who had spent basically their whole Marine Corps careers deploying to either Iraq or Afghanistan. Oh. And I cannot tell you how many of those that came to me and talked to me and said, Major Middleton, what was all that for? Mm-hmm. And that to me was the most disheartening thing, to know that these young men and women had spent years of their lives training, deploying, and being in harm's way. And for them to come back and not have a very clear sense of what they were doing that for and what it was for, that is very disheartening to see that in our young folks, who I think, by the way, is a phenomenal generation that is coming behind me and coming behind you. This young generation, these folks that I saw, they're young Marines, phenomenal. They are going to be fantastic citizens, and I think better citizens because their eyes are going to be wide open.
Now, you spent how many years in the military?
20 years in the Marine Corps.
Yeah. And you now have your own company.
I do, White Top Aviation.
All right. And what does White Top Aviation do?
We do aviation risk, and we also have been starting to do some drone and unmanned aircraft systems work.
Ooh, that's scary.
A lot of people do think it's scary, but that's kind of why we've gotten into that work.
It's kind of the wave of the future, though, isn't it?
I think it is, depending on how it unfolds. I think the technology and the use of the UASs is becoming very prevalent. It's expanding way faster than the federal government or any regulatory agencies can handle it. And although the FAA, I think, is doing an admirable job trying to keep up, certainly working within the bureaucracy is very hard. And that's kind of why myself and my partner got into this, because with our aviation background, we have flown to national airspace. We understand the dangers. And we also, you know, have been in those situations. I've almost run into a couple of drones when I've been on military exercises, and it's bad enough when military organizations, we can't get it right and we almost have accidents. But you can imagine
what is with the commercial?
With these drones in the hands of just any person who's never been in a plane or who's never actually flown in the national airspace and understands the rules and regulations. It's gonna take some time to sort it out. What I hope doesn't happen is that there's no serious accident in this interim period while we're all trying to figure it out and get the rules and get it trained.
So anybody without any background really or experience can be in control of these drones?
Absolutely. You can, for anywhere from $900 to $1,500 or less, you can get a piece of technology that is extremely powerful, that it can go up to an altitude that would certainly interfere with a large portion of our civilian aviation, helicopters, light aircraft, and even larger, you know, airline aircraft. Absolutely. And one of the biggest problems is people's lack of understanding of the airspace in our country. There's a whole rule that, you know, that we had to learn as pilots and adhere to if you're flying in our national airspace structure. Most lay people don't understand that airspace structure and understand how it's clearly defined and delineated. So there's a lot of learning that needs to go on, and I think they're trying to balance between, you know, allowing the citizens of this country to be free to operate and do the things they want to do, but, you know, the public safety and safety to aviation.
So you mean they could actually endanger a jetliner filled with people going from one city to another?
Absolutely. And I know for a fact that, you know, as I was retiring, I was working up at HMX-1 with the president in that detail. I know the Secret Service was getting very, very concerned with the prevalence of these UAS aircraft and certainly the ability to do bad. Now, I want to temper that because there's a lot of amazing things that this technology, I think, can do from both a transportation standpoint, emergency management, and technology that we're going to be able to do better and more efficiently. But with most any technology, there can be used for good or can be used for bad. So they're both there.
So, and you were a helicopter pilot. I know that you had the President of the United States and many very high-level officials that you have had in your care.
Yes, I was honored and had privilege to fly at HMX-1 out of Quantico there, and we flew the President and Vice President, and there were other heads of state and senior government officials that we would sometimes fly. So, yes, I did that for a little while.
Let's talk a minute about the military and the opportunities that maybe are there for young people. What do you see in that?
I think there's still a lot of opportunities in the military. First of all, I went in the military all those years ago and kind of had it back.
Oh, yes, you're such an old man.
In the back of my mind, well, I'll do this for a few years and then I'll probably be done. You know, little did I know 20 years later, you know, I'd be retiring from it. But looking back on that, the experiences I had, I mean, were certainly unique to the military. I don't think you can find them anywhere else in the civilian sector. And I would certainly encourage, you know, the young people in this country to look at the military. What's been disheartening or what was kind of frightening to me is I was at a event a few weeks ago and the speaker was talking about the selection process for young folks coming into the military. And I guess they did a study that basically, if you took our young population, you know, between the ages of maybe 18 and 25, I think is the range he used, mm-hmm. I think his number that he quoted was like 4% would actually be able to join the military because of the rules and the regulations that we have made. So my point is, we may have a large pool of potential candidates, but the selection process and the way we've structured ourselves is going to limit that pool. And then if you look at that 4%, and you're looking at probably some of the brightest, best, you know, educated, most physically fit, is the military versus something else in the private sector going to be as attractive to them? And I think for a long time, the military has relied upon a sense of patriotism and certainly adventure and travel and things like that to bring in these candidates. I just don't know how that's going to hold up over the next, you know, several years, especially if we have politicians who are going to start tinkering with such things as the retirement system that the military has had in place for several years.
You have to give people an incentive to do something.
Well, and I think it's very different because, I mean, you know, people use the word incentive a lot, and you know, it can be talking about bonuses, money, benefits. But what I always try to tell people is, like, you know what? There's talking about incentives, but then there's talking about a contract, a compact between two, you know, two entities. And in this case, it's one thing to offer somebody a bonus if you want to come work. Well, when you come to work for a company, you can leave that company. They can fire you. Yeah. They cannot demand of you to do certain things. At some point, you could say, I'm done. I'm not going to do that.
I'm out of here. Yeah.
In the military, you don't always have that luxury. There is a portion of freedom as a citizen that we basically turn loose of when we raise our right hand and take an oath to defend this country. And my point is, if you want to start tinkering with a system that says, well, we'll just replace a retirement or medical benefits with a 401k, I don't think that's going to sell because you're not talking apples to apples there. You're not asking people to come join a corporation and they can leave the next day. They're joining a corporation.
They're making a commitment.
That they may say, you're going to get on a plane or ship and you're going to go fight and get shot at. Just offering someone a 401k, that's not the selling point that I think is going to win the day for continued service in our military. So I think that's something they really need to look hard at. And I know there are, you know, lots of organizations like the Military Officers Association that are, you know, really pressing Congress and, you know, and the President's office to say, listen, you better be very careful before you start tinkering with this system that we've had in place.
How many years did you spend in the Marines?
20.
20 years?
Yes, ma'am.
And you were a helicopter pilot.
Yes, ma'am.
And you had many famous people, including the President of the United States, put on your plane, which meant the responsibility. They trusted, respected your ability, right?
Yes, ma'am. Mine and the other Marines and crews. Yeah, because it goes all the way back. It's not just the pilots. It's that air crew. It's that crew chief. It's those mechanics. It's those operators. That was the whole team of putting that package together.
And we have to go to a break, but I want to ask you, do you think in the world today, in this country, the way people are thinking, do you think that there is opportunity for young people in the military?
Should we answer when we come back?
No, I want you to answer right now because that's important.
I think there absolutely is opportunity for young people in the military, yes.
So they need to graduate from high school.
At a minimum, yes.
And
they need to keep their nose clean.
Yeah.
They don't need to be going out there getting in trouble, arrest records. They need to be getting their high school education and absolutely keeping a clean record. For instance, you know, years ago, you know, sometimes the judges would say, you can either go to jail or you can go to the Marine Corps.
Yeah.
Those days are probably long gone, you know. Yeah. But I think there's a danger in that. If we always want just the squeaky, clean citizen to join the military, I think you're going to forego a lot of talent that maybe they've got a blemish on their record. Maybe they've got a bad mark or a misstep somewhere in their life. And then in this day and age when everything is filmed and cataloged and videoed and interneted to death, you know, it's almost there's a sense of you can't get away with anything without having a permanent mark on your record. My point to that is, I've known a lot of people that I served with in the Marine Corps and other branches of the service that were arrested. They may have done something or had a misstep, but they were fine, great serving military officers and enlisted people. So I think we just, again, we need to be very careful of that.
Well, I don't think there's such a thing as a person who hasn't made a mistake in their, I mean, if they're, I'd like to meet that person because I don't think they exist.
Well, isn't that a funny thing? Because exactly, we expect these young officers and enlisted folks coming into the military to have perfect records with no blemishes, yet we accept the blemishes and the stains of our senior politicians.
Oh boy, and how. With that, we're going to go to a quick break and we'll be right back.